Amen. If you see anybody sleeping on a day like this, the person needs more than deliverance. He needs overhauling. I don't know whether we're going to finish this thing here today or whether we have to continue next time, but I'll see how far we can get. Because I am going to be very sluggish. Amen. Because I want you to understand everything. So it's important. There's no point in rushing when it's not clear. Amen. Many of daddies and mommies at the adult service now, they wish that when they were your age, somebody sat them down and told them what I'm going to tell you now. But they didn't know. And many are full of regrets now. So we're looking at choosing your life partner. And nobody is too young to listen. Even those who have been married can still listen. Although if you are married, well, congratulations, too late. The only prayer Gio can pray for you is that God should supply you with iodine, bandage, first aid equipment to treat it as you go along. Amen. Praise the Lord. Choosing your life partner. The first point that needs to be made, and very clearly too, which I want you to listen carefully now. That very first point, don't miss it. The first point is this, that the next worst thing after hellfire is bad marriage. What did I say just now? That's right. The next worst thing that can happen to a man after hellfire is a bad marriage. That singular decision on who you marry determines the totality of your destiny. It will tell us whether you are going to fail or succeed, whether you are going to survive or you are going to sink. That singular decision. That's why on wedding days, if you have ever attended a wedding, if you listen carefully to those words that are read to them, they are dangerous words. In fact, those words, I used to call them death sentence. Because they will say, marriage is not something you just go inside, like a brute that has no brain. Have you ever listened to those things? I'm reading it in modern English for you, but the traditional Shakespearean English will tell you something else. But the real interpretation is that this is not something you do without thinking deeply, without working hard, without knowing what to do. That's what they tell them on that wedding day. Unfortunately, many put on the sheepish smile and say, I will. You didn't even bother to hear what they say. I will. A man has just finished fighting with his wife. And somebody was preaching to him outside. Say, Mr. Man, you better listen to this message. If not, you will go to hellfire. The man said, I'm already one. So the next worst thing after hellfire is what? A bad marriage. That singular decision will determine every other thing you do. If you are an elephant and you marry an ant, you can't put ant and elephant on the same bed. What will happen? Can an elephant sleep with an ant? Can an elephant have sex with an ant? Because he cannot even locate the ant. When a cockroach decides to marry a spider, well, they can merge a little bit. Both of them are dark in color, but one of them is a night creature, the other one is preparing and producing net in the factory. So they look a bit alike, but it's still a wrong marriage. This is a very serious thing. So the choice of a life partner is one of the most critical choices of your life. Outside your decision to become a Christian, the next decision in your life is your marriage partner. What you become in life is a combination of the choices you make anyway. So once you choose the wrong one, you are in trouble. If you marry a deficit, you marry zero, and what you have before was one, by the time you pay the one back to the zero, you level at zero. If you are zero yourself and you now marry somebody who is also zero, that is zero plus zero is equal to zero, then the children that zero will give back to will be equal to what? Zero multiplied by whatever. So outside your salvation, the next most important decision is the choice of who to marry. To marry the wrong person is a disaster and is a tragedy. And the enemy, this way, the devil knows that once he succeeds in matching the wrong people together, the whole world is destroyed. He knows. The devil knows that once two people marry each other and they have a sort of combination that will not allow his kingdom to prosper, he knows that he is in trouble. So he struggles so hard so that people don't make the right choices. Immediately the devil has married you to somebody you are not supposed to marry to, is already playing with your destiny. If you now go and marry somebody who is not born again, an unbeliever, what you've just done to yourself is to make the devil your father-in-law. And the devil is an unkind father-in-law. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. So if you are into a relationship now, and you are not really sure whether that's where God wants you to be, the best thing is to pack it up and go and pray again to know whether you are in the right thing or not. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. Are you there? It should be very easy to find. And the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make a helpmeet for him." The decision to find Adam a wife was God's decision. And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all cattle, and to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helpmeet for him among those animals: serpents, scorpions, tiger, lion, crocodile. Adam look at them, it's crocodile, no. Lion, no. So, no. Didn't find anybody among those animals that is helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the rib instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. Who brought Eve to Adam? God. And Adam said, "This is now the bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman," meaning the womb man, because she said taken out, because she was taken out of man. "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife," singular, didn't say his wives, "and they shall be one flesh." And were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Singlehood is bad if not ordained by God. The Bible says, God says it's not good that the man should be alone. These animals can be his companion. And God decided to move on and get a wife for him. Singlehood is bad if it's not ordained by God. Look at Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Ecclesiastes, you find that after Psalm, after Proverbs. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9. Ecclesiastes 4, 9. Are we there? What does it say? Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. Verse 10, for if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. 11, again, if two lie together, then they have it, but how can one be warm alone? 12, and if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. You see the advantages of having company there. Two are better than one. They will have reward. They can fight a better battle. They can stand very well. They can withstand adversity. They can listen to each other, gain advice from you, gain advice from the other, and then move forward with their lives. Two are better than one. The enemy also knows this one very well. In Proverbs now, go back to Proverbs. Proverbs 18:22. Proverbs is just at the front of the Ecclesiastes we just read. It's important we look at these scriptures very well so that you know how well we are going to base our teachings. Proverbs 18:22. Are we there? What did he say? Whoso findeth a wife, findeth what? A good thing. And then the person has obtained favor of the Lord. You need favor of God to find your partner. The Lord God Jehovah is the source of marriage, as we have read. He said, whosoever findeth a wife, findeth a good thing. He didn't say, whosoever findeth a husband. Why? You're not supposed to be finding a husband. The husband is supposed to be finding you. I'm not supposed to be saying, I'm available. No. Because if a man is finding something, it means he's looking for it. And if he's looking for it, when he finds it, he will find it valuable. But if he didn't find it, I'm available. I'm available. I'm available. So how many of you are available here? And he begins to say, you are too slim. I don't like you. Your back is too narrow. I don't like you. You walk like a crab. I don't like you. So you are giving him choice to be comparing and contrasting and to be doing random sampling. Whosoever findeth a wife, findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor from God. Instead of some men to pray for favor of God, no, they are busy contrasting and comparing. And that is a root of marital failure. When you find a thing, you pray, you work hard to find it, and you value what you found. But if it's offered to you free of charge, then it has no value at all. That's why it is dangerous for you as a woman when at any small provocation you have pulled off your skirt. So shall I remove my bra too? Small provocation. So you just devalue your womanhood and you make yourself so cheap, and then you become a cheap woman. Very soon they add your name to their list. This one, 10. Then you become a discussion among men. It's a sad thing, but many people don't understand. I see plenty of people these days, especially overseas. I've seen this in Nigeria too. They have what you call a teddy bear husband. Having steady bear there, always hugging. By the side of the bed, they're hugging it. God does not want you to marry teddy bears. Because that teddy bear that you are hugging and hugging and it's not talking back to you. If you think you are going to marry somebody, will not talk. You are making a mistake. So the choice of a life partner, beloved, is a test. One of the greatest tests you must pass through. It will not have been that difficult if not the devil, who doesn't want the right partners to come together. The choice of a partner will have a long, long impact on everything you do. And everything you, and it will have an impact on everything you will become in life. It will either make you or make you. It will determine for you whether you will make heaven or not. If your wife decides, determine that you are not going to heaven, finish, you won't go. Yeah. It takes a woman 5 minutes to scatter a church. Yes, pastor's wife, 5 minutes to scatter the church. I had a friend, a bishop in East Lagos. He had a congregation, 1,500. And one day, there was a service like this. Madam went forward and took the microphone. And said, shout hallelujah. Everybody said hallelujah. Said, this man, bishop, that you people are calling bishop there, he's a fornicator. He's a fornicator. So he's going to give you communion now. You are going to eat communion from a fornicator. I tell you. Plenty of argument. Say it's not true. Our bishop is not like that. Some say it's true. Some say it's not true. Some say, will you know him better than his wife? Is that not his wife talking? That was an open disagreement. Some people didn't wait for the communion. They went away. By the next Sunday, the 1,500 congregation had become 10. 5 minutes, scattered everything. That's why that great apostle, Babalola, who is the father of Pentecostalism in Nigeria, one day he called all his pastors together. He said, how many of you want to make heaven? He says, sir, me. How many of you want to make heaven? How many of you want to enter the gate of life? He said, I want to enter, sir. He said, ask your wife. Ask your wife. If your wife said, I'm not getting in, finish. So that is what will determine whether you make heaven or not. So it's an important decision. Now, I will give you that small introduction. I want to give you now 15 wrong reasons for getting married. Some people get married for the wrong reasons. Let's look at these reasons one by one. How many reasons? 15 wrong reasons for getting married. Number one, you must not get married because of lust. L-U-S-T. Some want to marry only because they want to have sex regularly. That's the reason. That's the idea of marriage, is regular sex. Monday, 5 hours. Tuesday, 2 hours. 2 hours, 3 hours. That's no other reason. Only. I was in Canada. A Canadian lady came to me and said, pray for me to get your husband quick. I said, what? She said, I don't want to remain a virgin. She said, I want sex. I mean, that's why she wants to go and get married. Now, when you now get married on the foundation of sex, and you want to be doing 1 hour per day or 2 hours, and you have a partner who doesn't have that kind of stamina, then the marriage collapses. Or the man is going outside again, the woman too is going outside again. A lot of what you call love, it is not love at all. The proper word is lust. Lust. And by the time you know it's lust, you are already lost. Marriage is a relationship. And it's not just something out of just lust. Lusting after a person. So you must. The one wrong reason to get married is what? Lust. The Bible says part of the problem of the earth is lust of the heart. A lot of people's hearts are dirty with lustful desires, sexual desires, and all kinds of things like that. Two. Second wrong reason for getting married is what the white man calls infatuation. I just infatuated. That is love at first sight. Sudden love. I just as I saw you like that. It's a chemical reaction that took place in my heart. I just knew inside me that the way the chemistry worked is you. Infatuation. Love at first sight. All those kind of sudden love always ends in disaster. Three. Well, another wrong reason for getting married is liking the idea of marriage. Just like it. Oh, I want to be called Mrs. So-and-so. I want to have one woman by my side holding my hand when I walk on the street. So that makes you to ignore the reality of the marriage because you are marrying for the wrong reasons. It's like somebody say, "Ah, why do you want to become a soldier?" I say, "I like the uniform." Like the uniform. Well, after you have become a soldier and they put uniform on your head and they say, "Now somebody is fighting Congo, let's go." I say, "Ah." I say, "Does it mean that a bullet could hit me?" "Yes." "Nobody joins the army with the promise that you will not die." "Why do you want to become a lawyer?" "Who, you see that gown and the wig? I like it. "Why do you want to marry?" "Ah, the wedding gown. Ah, fantastic. My own. Although I'm size 14 now, I'll get size 12 so that when they put me inside." If that is your reason for getting married, it's a wrong reason. What's the first wrong reason? Two? Three. Just like the idea. Four. Is the fear of remaining unmarried. The fear of remaining unmarried. When a person is afraid, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, nobody is saying anything to you. Say, hey. So you start getting scared. Say, "Ha, is this how they are going to push me aside? What have I done wrong now? What should I change? What should I do? That fear causes an evil drive that will make the lion to marry the spider. Such people eventually fall in love with the first person that appears to be serious with them, whereas it's the wrong choice. Because they're just afraid. Whereas the Bible says, "Trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not on thy own understanding." The Bible says, "Let not your heart be troubled, but believe in God and believe in me also." The Bible says, "The battle is not for the strong, neither is the race for the swift." The fact that they say, "Get on your marks, get set, go," and you are the first person to take off, doesn't mean you are the one who will win. The fact that you got on the boxing ring, and they say on the red corner you find Ringo, on the left corner you find Jigo, begin to fight, and they give Jigo a blow, bam, first round, and he fell down, and they counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It doesn't, and he stood up. It doesn't mean that because he fell down on the first round, he will lose the fight. So that's why you. Amen. So that's why you must not copy people. If you copy people, you stop being an original. You become a photocopy. The Bible says, comparing themselves by themselves, they are not wise. And even our forefathers who never read the Bible, they say fingers are not equal.
I'm not reading the Bible, but they know that our lives are not the same. So don't start copying and say, my junior sisters are married. And the ones that I was at the naming ceremony, that one is married. The one that I've become chief bridesmaid for number one, number two, number three, number four. If you are tired of chief bridesmaid, then stop it. Number five is pressure. 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 It's a mistake to just sit down one day without prayer and take your pen and say, by so year, I must have finished this. By December 2011, I must be married. You have fixed, you have personally, without consulting the Almighty, fixed a date or stage in your life by which you will be married, and that puts you under terrible pressure. When that date you have fixed in your heart is now getting close, you start getting anxious. From anxiety becomes agitation. From agitation it becomes panic. Panic. And under panic, you now make a mistake. Because you have married a panic husband. What is the first wrong reason for getting married? Two? Three? Four? Five? Sometimes those pressures may come from your own family people. Your daddy will say, excuse me, when are you bringing a boyfriend here? Mom will say, excuse me, when are you going to bring somebody here? And they're putting pressure and pressure and pressure on you. I was a teacher in the evening class many years ago. I taught biology in the evening class. The evening class is an interesting place to teach because at least in that class where I was teaching, everybody on the front row could be my father. We call it adult education. Everybody on the front row, yes, could be my father. But one of us was a young, how a young girl came to that class, I don't understand. I didn't know they were putting her under pressure at all. I didn't know the parents were harassing her, they were pressurizing her. They took away her school fees, they took away her class, and they said, go and marry. And she was a child of God, she was born again. She said, well, if because you are sponsoring me to school, you are trying to pressurize me to marry, I will go to adult education class, which I can afford. So she was going to these cheap evening classes, subsidized by government. I was surprised what she was doing there. One day, I was in class, and a woman came, very thick Lagos madam. And she said, come. I was teaching her class. She approached at the back of the class and said, you, come. I said, okay. So, I left my teaching. I went to her. I said, that girl over there. I said, yes. So she's my daughter. I said, yes. Are you the teacher? So yes, I teach biology. I said, okay. So do you know why she's in this class? I said, no, you used to wonder. I said, well, it's because she's disobedient. So I want you to stop her from coming to this class. That's why I'm here. And I called the sister. So what's the matter? That one I explained to me. They said, when am I going to bring the sugar daddy home? When am I going to bring this person home? And I said, I'm not ready yet. I want to pray. I'm a child of God. And this and that and that. And the woman said, she turned to me and said, you see the foolish thing she said? See the foolish thing she said? And she didn't know who I was. Amen. So when the woman has finished, I said, madam, would it have been nice for this lady to come up with a pregnancy that has no father? Wouldn't it have been nice for her to just go into the street and sleep with all kinds of men around and then mess your name and the name of your family up? Now look back, myself. Are you part of them? I said, hey, this world. It is handsome man. You have joined this SU. Hey! So, pressure should not make you to lose focus. Six.
escaping from being jilted. Escaping from being jilted. That is, you were with somebody. The person has jilted you. So, another person has now come. So, because you fear being jilted, quickly you rush into marriage with that one. It's a wrong reason to marry. Many of the, I was jilted. In fact, whenever I see people who are jilted, I congratulate them. So, because if he's a proper man, if he's your husband, he will not jilt you. Ojaba Road, 1993. A lady wants to marry. A week to the wedding, the man showed up and said, "No, I am no longer interested. The wedding gown has been done, everything has been done. I'm no longer interested." You know the way they pack dirty clothes from the floor. That's how they pack the lady to me at the counseling room. It was like jelly. And she was saying, "Let me die. Let me die. Dr. Olukoya, let me die." I said, "Why do you want to die?" She said, "The man just jilted me." I said, "But God can open a fresh door to you." He said, "Dr. Olukoya, you don't understand. So the worst thing was that the man ran away with the chief bridesmaid. And it was the chief bridesmaid of this lady the man eventually married. So I consoled her, prayed for her, and so on and so forth. 2 weeks after the wedding, to the chief bridesmaid, they were both traveling to Sowa in Shagamu. They had an accident, the two died. That quickly shook the sister out of his shock. That sister is married to one of our pastors now. Amen. Anytime I see her, because the husband is now abroad, I will say, "Hey, Dr. Olukoya, let me in." Shout hallelujah. If I'd allowed you to die now, will you be here? The seventh wrong reason for getting married is for getting married for money. Money. Money does not guarantee success in marriage. Money does not buy happiness. Money can buy you spectacles, but it cannot buy your eyes. Money can buy you bed, but it cannot buy you sleep. Money can buy you the pews in the church. You can buy pews in the church, a special seat for you in the church, but it cannot buy you salvation. Money can buy you plenty of textbooks, but it cannot buy brain. Money can buy you plenty of food and tantalizers and sweet sensation, but it cannot buy the appetite. So there are plenty of things money cannot buy. Money cannot buy happiness. Unfortunately for the sisters, many of the extra nice men are not rich. Unfortunately. And many sisters who say, "Well, I just want to marry anybody. I want to marry somebody who will carry my load." Which load? "No, I'm looking for somebody. Oh, I want to be pampered. Looking for somebody who's going to look after me." In this campus, there was a lady in our class when we were studying here. The lady used to say, "I must marry a pilot. I must marry a pilot. At whatever cost, I must marry a pilot." Yeah, she married a pilot. She's married to a pilot, but the last time I saw her, all the front teeth were gone. And she had only one good eye. Because this pilot had been using her as a punching bag. Money. When you're going to marry a person, don't look for money. It's not money. Money. A lot of people are looking for comfort. Money. No, 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 no. Must have a fast car, must have a big car, must do this, must do that. That fellow without a car may be able to buy 200 tomorrow. Amen. But that is not an excuse. It's not an excuse for you, a man, to swallow the sweet of poverty of your father's house. Amen. Number 8. A person is marrying for the wrong reason if you are using that marriage as an escape route. An escape route. Say, I'm tired of my daddy and my mommy. I must get out. I want to escape from this problem in the house. I wake up in the morning. I'm the one who will sweep. I'm the one who will cook for them. I'm the one who will do this. The one who will do that. No, 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 no. I can't go on like this. If I'm married now, they can't drag me from my husband's house to come in and be washing plates. No, 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 no. I must go. I must leave home. I can't stand my daddy. I can't stand my parents. I can't stand my mother. So you left because you use it as an escape route. And when it's an escape route, it's because some people are lonely and they're unhappy, they're motivated to leave. Sooner or later, they face the same problems they're trying to run away from. Sometimes, it's like jumping from frying pan into the fire. Into the fire. At least, your father will not bring somebody home to come and compete with you. But the man can bring a woman home to come and compete with you. How many things have I told you now? 8. What's the fourth one? Yes. The ninth wrong reason for getting married is having pity. You feel sorry for the man or woman. Say, hey, somebody is punishing this man like this. The man said, you see, I'm a divorcee. My first wife broke my head. Second wife broke my leg. Third wife broke my back. So I'm looking for somebody who will pity me. Say, sorry. He said, can you marry me then? Yes. You will have treated me. Say, yes. Sorry, Pele. Sorry. Biko. You don't marry out of what? Pity. And I used to think in the past that it's only the women, because there are some people I call Sister Pure Water. Sister Pure Water, just any small thing, start crying. I call them Sister what? Water. I used to think it's only the sisters who do Jeremiah, but I've seen men. See some men crying like babies. Even pastors. Yeah. One day they took a pastor, they transferred him from one place to the other. And the man came to complain to me. The pastor is a very fat man. Oh, I've never seen a fat man crying like that. He cried and his body was vibrating. Gee, you are our father. You can't sit around like this and let them move me from a congregation of 2,000 to 300. This is unfair. Unfortunately, only few women can stand men crying. Only few. I saw a man brazen and cry like, he said, sorry, you said we are making me cry. So you don't marry out of pity. 10. Another wrong reason to marry is foolish expectations. Very foolish expectation. You are marrying an unbeliever and you are believing that you will get born again. Is your own key of salvation in your own hand? Were you the one that made yourself born again? It's foolish expectation.
You see a man who is smoking Indian hemp, and you say, well, since I met him, he has reduced it. He was smoking 10 weeds per day. Now I should reduce it to 2. I'm sure by God's grace, he will change.
Ha! Ah.
If they don't change before you marry them, you are in trouble.
Many a person, you've met a man, you can see that even as a young man, the temper is terrible. And you are hoping that when you marry, he will change. No. It's probably going to increase.
So, foolish expectation will cause trouble. Foolish expectation says it will change. You know, they never do.
11. Another wrong reason for getting married is beauty or handsomeness.
Beauty or handsomeness. Like I told you last week, to marry a man or a woman because of beauty and handsomeness is to buy a house because of the paint. Once the paint wears off, then you see. The best time to look at a woman properly is when she's just waking up. Not under the makeups. Makeup, the person who designed the name makeup did a very good definition. Makeup, that is, it's not up to standard. You are making it up.
But women who get their beauty from the Lord don't need to make up nothing.
Let that man see you as you are now. Because when you're now getting and all the paint and the panel beating and spraying has been removed, then you say, hey, blood of Jesus, this is what you look like.
Number 12 reason for getting married is accidental pregnancy.
Because you got pregnant mistakenly doesn't mean that you now have to bury your life into that marriage.
Well, you've made a mistake, you've had a child of fornication, who the Bible also defines as a bastard, but then,
well then that doesn't mean you should bury your destiny there. It's the wrong reason to get married.
13. Tribal connection. I must marry somebody from our town. Not only our town, our village. Not only our village, our clan.
Tribal connection.
14. Another wrong reason for getting married is just to satisfy your parents, parental satisfaction.
Satisfy them. You marry the friend of your daddy because your daddy is married.
You are satisfying them while hurting your destiny. And the last wrong reason to get married is in order to hurt your parents.
So people get married in order to just get at their parents and hurt them.
Yes.
How many reasons about you now?
Let's hear them one by one. Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14,
number 15. Those are the wrong reasons for getting married.
Wrong reasons for getting married.
The Bible gives us why marriage is created. It's for companionship, to have a companion. It's for procreation, to have children. And it's to fulfill the agenda of God for your life. I want you to understand this very well.
I believe you have been blessed by this video. If you have any question or prayer request or want a particular video topic, use the comment section below. Don't forget to like, comment and subscribe to this channel by clicking on the subscribe button and the notification bell beside it to be updated with new videos whenever available. Thanks as you share this video with your friends and family. God bless you.